Hello, you gorgeous, lovely people. This is Chris from Recombu, and I'm here with Motorola's shiny new Moto G6 Plus. So this is the most premium, action-packed member of the new G6 family. It's slightly larger than the other two models, and it's also got slightly better performance as well, according to the specs at the very least. We will see if that is indeed the case. We're just going to do an unboxing now, get it all set up, and run through the specs, the hardware, the software, so you know everything that you need to know about this lovely, shiny handset. So first of all, the box itself is, of course, as you can see, that lovely lime green colour that we enjoyed from the other two members of the Moto G family. We have, of course, done a full unboxing of the G6 and the G6 Play as well, so go check those out if you want to see more about the other handsets. But now we'll concentrate on the Plus model. There we go, there's the actual phone itself. We're going to stick that aside just for a second and just check out what's in the rest of the box. Well, this looks very familiar if you've already seen our other unboxings. Little cardy bit there, lots of stuff to read. Read me! It just basically shows you how to get the phone all set up. And lots of different languages. You also get, of course, a USB cable, shocker, Type-C, to actually power it back up. And a bit of a 3-pin power plug as well. Oh, and of course, not forgetting the little pin porky device, so you can actually get your SIM card in there and use it as a phone. And that's basically your whack. Easy job. Brush all that away, and then we can take a look at the sexy stuff, the actual handset itself. Now, first of all, worth pointing out, of course, that like the other two models in the G6 family, this comes wrapped in a protective sheath, so you can bang it about the place and hopefully it should stay nice and fresh. That lovely glass finish, which of course is brand new for the Moto G6 series. The previous one, the G5, was a metal monster. It was still quite attractive, but of course glass is all the rage these days. So there you go, there it is in all of its sexy glory. Let's just put the protective cover aside for a bit so we can actually see it in all of its lovely, lusty, glossy glory. I've drunk far too much coffee today, so I'm talking nonsense, just ignore me. So a little bit about price and availability. First of all, it's 269 quid. It will be when it's made available from May the 2nd here in the UK. You'll be able to pick it up from Carphone Warehouse, although I'm not sure the exact tariff arrangements just yet, so you'll have to stay tuned for a bit more information on that. But £269 SIM free. Let's just see if it's got any juice in the tank. Hopefully it will. Yep, there we go, and get it all set up and everything. So of course, a little bit more about the design. It is like the standard G6 and the G6 Play. It's all glass, but like the G6, it's Corning Gorilla Glass number 3, so it should hopefully prove rather rugged. We've been rocking the original G6 for a full week now, and there hasn't got any scratches or scuffs on it. Hello, Motor. So I reckon that you should be expecting exactly the same from the Plus model. Hopefully it should stay nice and blemish-free, even if you decide to risk unsheathing it and going naked instead. As you can see, obviously the camera lens does jut somewhat from the surface. Seems to jut slightly more than the standard G6, but not to any kind of worrying degree or anything. And of course, it's got these lovely, pleasing curved edges and corners. Some really nice contour effects going on. You sort of bend it to the light. It just refracts the light very nicely, very neatly. Certainly looks like a very premium handset, despite the fact that it is only 269 quid. Unfortunately, unlike quite a lot of flagship rivals out there, it's not fully water resistant, but the G6 Plus is at least P2I rated, so that means it's water repellent inside and out. So you should be able to take it out in the lovely clement British weather, as we have right now, and it can get a good old soaking, and hopefully touch wood should be alright. The G6, again, P2I certified as well, and that was absolutely fine in the chocking rain. That's not a word, but whatever. So it can get super wet, but I wouldn't go dropping it in your sink while you're doing the washing up or anything like that. It'll probably meet with its demise, unfortunately. And you can also pick it up in this lovely deep indigo colour, which is very, very shiny and sexy, or you can also pick it up in the Nimbus colour. Nimbus being a big dark grey cloud, I guess it's kind of a grey finish for it. I quite like the deep indigo, to be honest. It looks really, really nice. It tends to hide those smudges and everything. You see, it does get a little bit scuffed up if your fingers were a little bit greasy. So definitely don't go wielding it after eating a doner kebab. That's never a good idea. But on the whole, a very nice sleek finish indeed. Like the standard G6, of course, you get the fingerprint sensor housed here beneath the display rather than actually slapped around the back like you do on the G6 Play, which is a shame because we quite like the G6 Play's rear-mounted one, but hey-ho, that's just us. Of course, nice bit of Motorola branding there. And then if we just do a quick tour of the sides, nothing really too much to talk about here, just volume rocker and power button. Down below you get your Type-C, USB, and of course a nice bit of 3.5mm headphone jack, so if you want to get all wired up, that's all fine. And then up top you'll find the SIM tray, which also doubles as a micro SD memory card slot as well. More on that in a moment. First of all, I will just get it all set up. This should only take a moment. Set up as fresh. Just gonna quickly add the fingerprint, which should be nice and straightforward, just like with the other models. Nice and responsive, despite the fact it's a really slender sensor, as you can see there. It's proved perfectly accurate on the G6. We've had absolutely no trouble with it whatsoever with responsiveness or anything like that. So there you go, that's one added. And then, as you can see, it locks your phone, obviously. Agree to all the terms and services. You can set up Face Unlock as well, which is Motorola's special version of Face Unlock. So let's just allow that. And this is a pretty straightforward process as well. Just stick your face in there, keep your eyes open. Ooh. There we go. And as you can see, you can bypass the lock screen and everything as well. It seems to be reasonably responsive, not quite as good in low light as Huawei's version, but it does the job absolutely fine. I'll demonstrate that in a sec. And so there we are into Android Oreo 8.0.0. Just dive into the system. About phone, as you can see there, 8.0.0 is basically in its vanilla form as well. Motorola's done very little tinkering whatsoever. It basically looks exactly how Google intended. The only Motorola addition is the Moto app, which adds a variety of suggestions on how to get the most out of the phone, how to extend the battery life, things like that, once you've actually used it for a bit. And then you've got various features thrown away in there. If you want to see more on these features, go check out our G6 tips and tricks guide. We've gone through each of these in succession. The Moto key, which basically replaces your passwords with a quick fingerprint scan. Moto Actions adds all kinds of useful stuff. So for instance, you've got the one button navigation, a different way of getting rid of the navigation bar and going back, doing the home and all that kind of stuff. Swipe to shrink screen. Swipe to shrink screen is quite a good option as well. Basically, if you swipe down towards the bottom of the bottom corner, that just makes it that little bit easier to use one-handed. So as you can see, and apps work in this mode and everything as well. So that just really, really eases the one-handed pain. As a 5.9 inch, it is obviously quite a big handset, so a bit of a struggle to reach the notifications tab and all the rest otherwise. Speaking of which, it's a 5.9 inch IPS display, so slightly bigger than the 5.7 inch you'll find on the G6. It's once again an 18:9 aspect ratio, very fashionable these days, so you're watching your bit of Netflix, you'll have not so much letterboxing and everything. It's quite good as well, because at least for a comfortable grip, it's like quite a nice narrow build, so not like the big old chunky monkeys of yesteryear. It's once again full HD plus resolution, however, so even though it's been slightly bumped in size, it's still nice, crisp images, as you can see there. You won't notice any individual pixeling or anything like that. And you can slightly customize it as well. If you dive into settings, go to display, got the color mode, you've got your vibrant mode set as default, but you can also knock it down to standard if you prefer more realistic images. To be honest, we quite like the vivid, really poppy colors that you get from that standard vibrant mode, so we're definitely happy to stick with that. As mentioned before, you do of course get the fingerprint sensor and the face unlock. So fingerprint sensor just works as you'd expect. Quick tap of that at any point and it immediately unlocks to your desktop. I say immediately, there is a bit of a pause. It's not quite as immediate as the likes of some of the Honor handsets, the OnePlus and everything, but it's reasonably nippy. You're not exactly hanging around. You know, you're not going to be tapping your fingers on the desk or anything like that. And you do get that face unlock as well. So if you just tap the power button, stick your face in the area, there you go. It'll just recognize your mug and unlock. And so far, as I say, it seems pretty good. It's just sort of nighttime, it struggles a bit, but apart from that, you can be wearing glasses, not wearing glasses, and it's absolutely fine, all good. So what have you got actually running the show? Well, it's a Snapdragon 630 chipset, and in this case, it's backed by 4 gigs of RAM, I believe. Let me just dive into the settings to check that. Yep, there we go, 4 gigs of RAM, and you get your 64 gigs of storage as well. And so we're expecting very, very nippy performance. The G6 had the occasional little sort of stumble and stammer, and we've once or twice had to like shut down Gmail because it wasn't quite responding right. But apart from that, it was absolutely fine for everyday use, and we found we could even play the likes of PUBG with just the odd little stutter in the frame rate. It was generally quite playable. So we're expecting at least the same from the Moto G6 Plus. Hopefully should do even better. We'll obviously do full benchmark testing and all that kind of shenanigans if you want to see all that on the go. And we're going to do a full G-series comparison as well for all the new G6 handsets too. As I mentioned before, 64 gigs of storage. If you dive in here, quite a large chunk of that is already used up, unfortunately. 12.79 gigs, as you can see there, so almost a fifth already. But you do have that micro SD memory card support. You can boost it by a further 128 gigs, not a massive amount, but to be honest, if you're going to be downloading a load of movies and stuff to watch while you're on the go, that is going to do the job quite nicely. And as for the battery tech, it's a 3200 milliamp cell, so slightly bigger than the Moto G6's 3000 milliamp, but not quite as massive as the 4000 milliamp found in the G6 Play. But we're still expecting well over a day of use from this. We're hoping that it'll keep you going all day. The Motorola Qualcomm Snapdragon 6 series is generally pretty good for the energy efficiency, so hopefully it'll be absolutely fine. Just going to boost the old sleep to 10 minutes. There we go. Wow! And of course, you've got the attentive display. We talked about that again in the G6 tips and tricks. And as you can see, you've got battery saver modes and all that kind of shenanigans as well. So that's all very handy indeed. And of course, well, should I mention the old charger that you get bundled in the box is a turbocharger, turbo power. So sounds like something out of a 1980s cartoon. But yeah, turbo power is great stuff. Should hopefully charge the battery in just over an hour and get you at least a day's worth of performance out of just sort of 20 minutes at the plug. So that's always good. And then, of course, there is the camera tech. So as you can see here, it's a dual lens snapper, just like the G6 before it. You actually get your two-tone LED flash there, which is lovely stuff. And if we load up the camera app, I'm expecting it to be pretty much the exact same experience as before. Oh, once we've allowed all the various permission bits, etc., etc. Yes, got it. Smart camera, it's a bit balls. So basically, yeah, this is the general setup. It's nice and straightforward. As you can see, you're straight into auto mode when you load the camera. You can, of course, do the old double twist with the wrist as well. I can't remember if that's set up by default. Let's have a look. Yeah, twist for quick capture. So if you your phone is hibernating and you quickly want to take a picture and you don't have carpal tunnel syndrome or anything, just do a quick double twist like this and you're straight into the camera app. It does, I do feel a little twinge these days when I do that. I'm getting rather old, unfortunately, so that's not a good thing, but never mind. As you can see, you can take shots quick, straight away, just with a quick tap of the shutter button. Go away, smart camera, you're so annoying. Or with a tap of the volume rocker as well. There you go. And just a quick swipe down, you're straight into the video mode. Unlike the standard G6, you can actually shoot up to 4K resolution video on this bad boy as well. If we dive down to photo video, here we go. 1080p, you can do up to 60 frames per second or the 4K Ultra HD resolution. So you do have that option, which is great. And hopefully the image stabilization will be okay. It wasn't great at 60 frames per second, but we will see how it does. Oh, there we go, back into the camera app. And if you swipe this away, then you get into the various photo modes. So of course you've got the usual spot color, portrait mode, which uses both of the lenses to lock on your subject and just provide a nice bokeh background experience, just help them stand out a bit. And you've got usual slow motion and time-lapse video modes as well. So again, we've covered all this in our in-depth G6 camera review, but stay tuned for a G6 Plus update. And then here on this left-hand side, you've got the likes of the auto-manual swap, so you can toggle between the two. And as you can see, that just gives you complete control of the likes of your white balance and everything, so you can tweak that and get it set up just the way you want, depending on the lighting conditions and everything else. Because it's an f1.7 aperture lens, hopefully the low light experience won't be too bad. I found the G6 was quite grainy once it got to low light, but as you'd expect from a budget handset, really. But we'll see how this one fares. Definitely stay tuned for a full update on that. And of course, you've got the lovely smart camera modes, the object recognition, which is not great, to be perfectly honest. We've tried capturing all kinds of stuff with this to see what it comes up with, and it generally just comes up with whatever it feels like. So for instance, here we've got that it is a grey bear plush toy. Good job there. And then for some reason, you've got a list of Toy Story characters and then just generic ads and searches for buying plush toys online. We've tried scanning things with Toshiba logos and it's pretended that it's a Samsung and all kinds of stuff. So I wouldn't rely on that too heavily, to be honest. And then if we swap around to the front facing camera, you'll find that it's got a flash feature built in there as well. So there you go. So you can even take your shots in those dingy low light basement bars and sexy cocktail clubs and all that kind of stuff. And of course you've got the likes of the beauty mode and everything to just freshen you up a bit. Not that I need it, obviously. So that in a nutshell is the G6 Plus. Looks like a decent little handset. It's a bit more expensive, as I say, than the standard G6, but you do get that performance boost. So if you're gonna be doing a lot of gaming on the go, we'd suggest probably looking at this model instead of the standard G6. But definitely stay tuned for in-depth review and everything. And we're gonna do lots of comparisons with some of the biggest flagships out there, such as the Pixel 2 XL, Sony's Xperia XZ2, just to see how it compares for the likes of performance, battery life, all that kind of stuff, to see if you really can get flagship quality experiences for less than half of the price and most of the rivals out there. So thanks for watching, everyone. Have a good one, and don't forget to subscribe if you feel like it. Don't feel like you have to, but it'd be nice if you did. And thanks a lot. Love you. Bye.